I'll give you the show. Don't know when it's connected.
We don't need to introduce the exhibition like all the art. It's not much to do that.
It'd be kind of a conundrum. I never can remember at like 14. I'm like, whoa,
yeah.
Close the store, or is it going to turn off? I'm just going to hear kids scream. Is that louder?
Well, we're live there now.
All right.
Well, no one's, it just says in private, so no one's able to see any of us, so it's only us.
Okay, so
you've used the text Soul Beaten by David Reed.
Yeah.
As a starting point for this group exhibition. I'm just wondering, can you give us a bit of an over insight into what soul beating means or how it applies to the exhibition?
Okay, soul beating is a phrase that was taught up by Milton Resnick, who was an American painter after kind of followed on from the abstract expressionists. So he's from that era, and he used the phrase to kind of talk about, I suppose, the difficulty of changing tactic as an artist, and the difficulty of changing style, and I became interested in this phrase because I think it, as artists or as painters, we try and find a style that is us in some ways, and that we can, for lack of a better word, brand as our own. And I found it interesting that, like, when we find that style, that we hold on to it and kind of marry it, and we commit to it over a lifetime. And I kind of wonder how creativity, in a way, fails, or may fail, in an individual if they, they don't try out different things and commit to the style, you know, just for the sake of, just because perhaps the public have got used to their style, or they have become recognized, or they have become validated because of this style. So I'm interested in just. Does creativity end when we marry this style of, you know, that is us to the public and to ourselves? So soul beating is, I suppose, I can't actually concentrate on it. But soul beating is, I suppose, based around this idea of the difficulty of changing. And it's also said in, David Reed was a student of Milton Resnick, and he writes about soul beating in the essay called Soul Beating. So I've used this essay, Milton Resnick's kind of term or phrase, as a way to build this exhibition of painting around.
Okay, and I'm kind of allergic to the word style, I think, because for lots of different reasons, but I mean, it's that idea of like marrying a way of working or like developing a way of working. And do you think that just applies to painters, or do you think that applies to lots of other artists, or different ways?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. I think painting, in a way, it kind of affects painting more, perhaps, because the history of painting, you know, the notion of a kind of identity that's embedded in painting, and the way painters go about painting in the studio every day, this kind of limited and limiting medium that has restrictions within the frame, and it's very competitive in a way, painting, because we've seen it all before, and everyone's really digging up the same stuff, digging up the same history, and they're putting it onto the canvas as their own, but it's just an adaptation of what's like before. So I think that for painters, the soul beat is very difficult. I think it's very difficult for them to look outside of their own work. It's really, and this notion of a painter having taste, and why did they, you know, how did they come to the conclusion that a painting's finished? And there must be an element of their own taste in the choosing of, you know, that final brush mark. You know, it is their taste saying, okay, that's done. Move on to the next. So I think painting is affected by soul eating more so than other mediums, which can kind of stretch out, you know, they're much more flexible.
Okay, so it's limiting then, I guess.
Yeah, painting is limiting in a way, and But that's what I'm fascinated by, you know, this, that limiting perspective, you know, that you can do so much within the frame as well, you know.
And in the text, we talked about Costan saying that painting is tragic. I guess that's another what to think about.
Yeah, there's a whole kind of, I suppose that goes all the way back to Mondrian. Mondrian talks about this, he uses this term tragic plastic. And but his idea of the tragic was that painting shouldn't have had this tragedy in it. You know, it should be very removed, and it should be very logical, and it should have, you know, steps. That contradicts this exhibition in a way. Because soul beating is very psychological tarot. It's really quite, it's a kind of self-reflection. It's about stepping aside of yourself and looking at the work. And, if the work is just style, is it just a thing that you've picked up over time, how do you see it anymore? So the exhibition is much more, it's not grounded in that logic, pragmatism of laundry. It's much more about, in a way, you know, challenging that, you know. So I think that I think that you didn't wander out there from it. You can more okay, no worries.
Let me just go back there. I didn't know, I'm sorry.
This is a tester, okay? Where was it? Psychology, yeah. It's a much more psychological exhibition. It's much more about, I think, the whys of painting rather than the whats of painting. Yeah.
And do you think you're soul beaten by curating? Is it something you think
Definitely, yeah. I've been affected by soul beating, especially over the last few years in my writing practice and as a former painter. And I changed a lot during art college. I kind of switched around. I was very promiscuous in a way, in my kind of art practice. So the exhibition is based about, it's very selfish in a way. It's I'm bringing all these painters together who have styles, who have built up styles, for lack of a better word, and or identities. They have established identities. They're not. I wouldn't say a lot of the artists in the exhibition are emerging. They've been around the block, and so I'm interested in, you know, talking with them, putting them together in an exhibition, and just challenging notions of, you know, style and soul beating.
Okay. And do you think there's any conflict of interest when you're an art writer or critic that you're curating a show? Does that come into play?
It's
a dangerous territory, I guess.
There's always a risk. Even meeting with artists now, I find that difficult, curating. Because in a way, my experience of being, you know, of curating is that you meet artists in their studio spaces, there's a privacy there. There's a generosity as well of them welcoming you in. So once again, you know, you can't be critical of that. You're stepping in rather than, as an art critic, you're stepping outside. You know, I think criticism comes from a kind of distance. And it's about stepping out of the art scene, or having one step out, or one foot out. So, this has been difficult for me because it's a much more intimate relationship with the artists.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm okay with that at the moment. I don't think it will affect my critical facility, because I hold that above everything else. But I think the exhibition will be critical rather than just a description of painting, you know?
And you said that painting doesn't bring energy to the act of writing. You find it quite
difficult.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
I suppose there's two reasons for that. I used to be a painter, it is difficult to have a distance. I was a painter for over 10 years, and also I found over the years that painting, in a way, kind of prompts description rather than criticism. and even a lot of the other art critics or art writers out there, they would do a lot of describing of painting, and a lot of metaphor, a lot of pretty writing. But painting, in a way, kind of, it's resistant to criticism, in a way, you know, it's very difficult. It doesn't energize my writing, that's just from a personal opinion, but I find it difficult. So I find much more criticality in other mediums, like film or photography or installation, or whatever, just contemporary art. Painting always is kind of something that is difficult to negotiate with criticism.
And you've said a few times that you used to be a painter, and now you have a website called I'm Not a Painter.
Mm.
And you think that there's with other artists or critics or writers or curators or other art practitioners, I guess, they often feel the need to say, I'm not part of that. Like, do you still think it's very separate to the rest of the art world? Is some kind of separation between painting and the rest of
the
visual art world,
yeah.
Not just visual art.
I'm going to close the story, even though it's really warm. I've talked to some people about this. Yeah, I think painting is separate. Is that your question?
Yeah.
Can you rephrase
it? Yeah, just that you have the website
yeah.
that's called I'm Not a Painter, and that lots of art practitioners would feel the need to say that they're not part of that group, that they're
artists.
Yeah, very much. And lots of painters would say that they're not painters, that they would that term is problematic, like that you would prefer to be called visual artists.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering why there still seems to be this go-to that we still separate painters from visual artists, that they're not just visual artists who make paintings.
I've been met by that a lot. I've called artists painters, and they say, no, I'm an artist. And I think there is that tension there, and I kind of like that tension. I do see, even here with your previous question about writing, I do find it difficult to write about painting. I think it is isolated. It is a kind of, it's not, I don't think, an underdog or anything like that. I think that it is separate, though, from visual art, because I don't know why that is. But I do feel it is, and like the phrase, I am not a painter, like Michelangelo said that in a poem 500 years ago when he was painting the Sistine Chapel. And I remember being in school and learning about Michelangelo being at the peak of his powers, doing that, and he was celebrated for it. But at the time he was writing these kind of very personalized, very kind of diaristic poems about feeling that he was not a painter, and he ends one of these poems with, I am not a painter, even though he's celebrated for being a sculptor, but he did do the Sistine Chapel. So, and then Frank O'Hara has a poem about, I am not a painter as well, and there's a kind of a desire in O'Hara to be a painter, but like there is that thing. I do separate them. That's just personally, I do separate painters from artists. I don't think it's a bad thing. I think artists, I'm not going to define what an artist is, but I think it's interesting, something interesting and something to be gained to be separate.
Do you think that as a show then it works best, or generally painting works best in exhibitions about painting, or they need to be, painters need to show, to exhibit beside each other, or can you imagine curating a show with lots of different...
This exhibition is all painting, and even the films that are being screened are about painting. So it's very focused on painting. I think that, for me anyway, I think painting, for me, as someone who's creating this thing, I think painting should be just isolated. And to be focused on, and I'm not interested in putting painting with film in a gallery in a way in the usual sense, or in sculpture, these kind of broad contemporary art curated exhibitions. I just wanted, I'm very interested in subcultures, and I'm very interested in tightening in a certain language that it, and making it more pure. So I feel that contemporary art does a lot of kind of, especially contemporary art curation, there's a lot of spreading out and broadening the palette. So I'm more interested in subcultures, one language teased out and see where you go with it. Like, because once again, it goes back to that, that idea that painting is limiting. And I think that trying to spread it across the canvas of other with other media just kind of breaks up what it is for me, what's special about it, you know.
It seems to be really popular at the moment again.
Yeah.
And then you had mentioned that you think it's a spark too much, but in in Dublin and Ireland at the moment. Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, it's become, all of a sudden now, it has been big around the world, I suppose, globally. All of a sudden it's very, really popular. There's lots of talks going on, even in the last year. There's lots of painting exhibitions going on. During the recession, painting kind of was on the back foot in a way. And there's a lot of installation work, there's a lot of artists from the spaces doing a lot of kind of DIY, institutional critique, all this kind of stuff. And I think painting was left outside of that discussion. So now we're coming out of recession, and there seems to be much more bigger interest in it. And I don't know why that is. I think, perhaps...
Is it driven by a market, do you think?
A little bit, I think so. Yeah, it has to be, And I think Instagram, I think painters in particular have embraced Instagram more so than the other artists. It's like a tribe on Instagram, and they're sharing, they're reposting. Other artists are a little bit avoided of it, a little bit, in comparison to the painting. That's my experience of Instagram now, is that painting is something that is, it's everywhere, it's ubiquitous on it. So I think painting, ironically, goes well with technology. We talk about photography destroying painting, and the internet at some point destroying painting, but television or whatever it was, but really they go hand in hand. So painting's doing well. This is coming at the peak. This exhibition is turning up at the peak of this kind of interest in painting. I think there's even in a few months there's a big talk in the RHA about painting or something like that. So. It's happening right in the middle of it.
We talked a couple of times about how you were very concerned and you wanted the exhibition to be a gender balanced exhibition, and it's something you were really determined to happen. And I'm just wondering how you get from that determination to having a show where you have 9 men and 5 women.
I know. It was one of the first conversations I had, and trying to become gender balanced, because there's a lot of female painters out there at the moment. And the minute I start explaining this, it's going to, I'm going to lose the argument. But it was kind of, I had my idea, I had my sights on a certain body, a certain kind of group of painters that I really wanted to show. It was nearly more female than male at the beginning, which was over a year ago now. And so how it turned out was that I approached these female painters and they weren't available. Then I started swapping them, I started to try and keep the balance, and I started to go for others, and just the way it turned out, more males were available, and some of the female painters were either didn't have works to supply, or they were too busy, or they were burnt out and didn't want to kind of commit to another exhibition. So once again, it goes back to this idea of popularity, and perhaps there's a lot of female painters out there being popular, that are popular at the moment, or the ones I have my sights on. So it was a case of kind of, because we don't have much resources, I suppose, I couldn't keep on, just because of gender balance, you know. So, I'm disappointed that some of the papers I wanted to get, I don't have in this exhibition. But the ones I have, I'm very happy with, you know.
Just on film, we've said that this is a painting exhibition seen through the lens of film.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, I suppose two things have happened. I teach here in Gorey School of Art, and I'm on the film and photography course. And so that has kind of piqued my interest in film. But there's also been a lot of films out there recently on painting, and that's another thing that has married very well with film, just documentary. So, and I'm also developing a film with filmmakers Saskia Vermeulen and Garrett Nolan, which started out as a 2 years ago as an overview of Irish painting, but since then has changed to something that's much more psychological and much more focused on the nature and nurture of painting. And so I've been working on that for 2 years. I've done countless interviews with Irish painters. So film was a kind of a natural, I suppose, accompaniment with painting. So over the course of the 9 days of the exhibition, there will be 9 films screened. The idea with painting, in a sense, there's one Star Trek episode which will be screened. And then we're doing these live broadcasts, and we're having some conversations with Irish painters as well. So it's kind of, I think they go well. And another way, we're talking about audience here, and trying to reach out to an audience online as well. So film, screen, internet was a good way of doing that, you know. Like 2 years, 2012, I co-curated Making Familiar with Robert Armstrong, who was the head of painting in NCID. And film was a big part of that as well. Actually, the Soul Meeting essay was part of that as well, in a sense. But we recorded interviews every week in that exhibition over a 6-week period. And we had them available in the gallery over the period of the exhibition. So I think, all those things has been going towards this kind of exhibition for the last 5 years. So this is a kind of reincarnation of that exhibition, in a way.
Do you think you'll curate future exhibitions? This is something
It's hard work. It's hard work. And I suppose my writing is first and foremost. So I think this does, as we talked about earlier, it does kind of compromise you as a critical writer, in my opinion, what critical writing should be and should exist. It's probably my last, or for a while anyway, until I get.
Until your soul beat.
Don't mind. 25 minutes.
All right.
25 minutes.
Okay.
Brilliant. Stop this here.